Hi, I'm Ben Ritchie.
Hi, I'm Ben Ritchie.
I'm really Ben Ritchie.
No, I'm really Ben Ritchie.
Yeah, but I was here first, so...
Actually, your real name's Mark.
That's true. Welcome to Central Online Midweek.
We got some good things going on. What have we got, Dad?
Well, we've got prayer points, we've got some worship, we're hearing from the Cartneys from their home this week, and we've got some answers to some questions that have been coming in as well, so enjoy.
What's your favourite quarantine snack?
Ben and Jerry's ice cream. I have had it like every night on quarantine and I'm enjoying it.
My quarantine snack at the moment is pistachio nuts, salted.
My quarantine snack is eggs. So please, they're like a necessity right now, so please stop buying them for your home bakes because I need them for the protein.
Oh, for me it's things like celery and, you know, a bit of carrot here and there, cucumber slices, healthy stuff.
In the morning I have cola and Skittles and ice cream. For lunch, I have chocolate and slush.
No.
And for...
Don't... Mom's watching this maybe, so... Can you...
Broccoli.
How can we love others during lockdown when we are stuck at home?
So for me, it is good to remember that everybody is going through lockdown together. So if I am struggling in a day, I'm thinking somebody else is struggling with the same things as well. So whether it's at work or whether it's at home or whether I'm not getting through something that I thought I was going to get through, it's if I can encourage myself with a Bible verse or if I'm reading the word and something jumps out at me, then I have found it good to encourage others with that thing as well. So I think encouragement, giving somebody a text, giving them a wave in the car, didn't I forget to smile people in Tesco's, I think that's our ways that we can love each other during lockdown.
How do you know Jesus actually lived on this earth?
I can. Because of 2020 and it keeps up to date when Jesus was born. It's been 2020 years since he was born.
It's good, so time tells us that Jesus was there. I think it's quite easy and simple really because Jesus was from an actual place. The country and the places that he went about are still here today. The city, Jerusalem, that he was in, where he was born, Bethlehem, it's still there. In fact, there's a place that you can visit that they say where he was born. The streets he walked are still there. The place that he died is still there. The place where his tomb was is there. It's all historical facts. There's more written about Jesus than there is about any other character of that time or before or just for a while after him as well. So the evidence is definitely there that Jesus was on earth. The bigger question, I suppose, is he who he says he is? Is he the Son of God? Is he God coming in the form of you know, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit? Is he the Lord? So he either was lying about it, he was either crazy, or he is Lord. So, and that's the big question still today. Who is Jesus to you? If you believe in him, if you've got real faith and that he's the Son of God, then he's Lord of your life and you know, we should follow him. So, yes, there is definitely evidence, isn't there? 2020.
Yep.
Stuff like that. Yeah.
How can I find out God's purpose for my life?
This was a big thing for me when I was growing up because I was always terrified about missing God's purpose for my life. But then I realised that actually God's purpose for our life is that we would know him and love him more and more every day. And there's a verse that I think is really important. And it's a verse that's quoted and on probably on your fridge magnet at home or something like that. And it says this: "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me and I will listen to you." And a lot of the times we can put that verse up and remember God's got a plan and a purpose for our life, but we actually need the context around that verse. And it says this: "You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and I will bring you back from captivity." And I think we need to understand that verse 13 of that Jeremiah 29:11-12-13 is this: it's that when we seek God, we will find him. And then when we're seeking him, we'll actually start to understand our purpose for our life, because he knows what it is, no matter what we're, who we are, what we're doing. It might be dentist, might be working in Tesco's, it might be a pastor, whatever it is, our purpose is to know him more and more, I think, I believe.
The Bible benefit my life.
It does. We wouldn't so much say that Christianity is a religion, but more so a relationship. And relationships are built on communication. And even in a relationship, you've got to allow your other person to self-define. Because it's easy for us to impose on that person who we think they are. But in relationships, we need to allow them to self-define. So the Bible is God's self-definition, and that's how we get to know him, by reading his word. And A.W. Tozer says this, I'll quickly get it. This is what A.W. Tozer says in Knowledge of the Holies. If what we conceive God to be, he is not, how then shall we think of him? If he is indeed incomprehensible as the creed declares him to be, and unapproachable as Paul says he is, how can we Christians satisfy our longing after him? The hopeful words, acquaint now thyself with him, and be at peace. And so we acquaint ourselves with God by pursuing him when reading his word. If the Bible is God's self-definition, then it's how we learn of him, know him, and build that relationship and that foundation with him. So absolutely, it's the best thing we can do in our walk with God.
How can I maximize the time I have during lockdown?
Okay, this is a funny question for me, because I am the biggest procrastinator queen out. I am not very good at using my time wisely. But for me, if I have something to get up for, so if I have something that I am looking forward to getting up to, then that is something that I can spend my day doing, or it's something that I'm looking forward to doing during my day. So for me, I would say get something first thing in the day that you're looking forward to getting up for, and then make a list for the rest of your day. And if you could get three, great, and if you didn't, then you've achieved one thing in your day.
What is faith?
Ben?
Faith is hope.
That's good, eh? Well, faith, I suppose, just as a word, is believing in something. Faith in God is a bit different. The Bible definition of faith, I think we spoke about this the other week, from Hebrews 11, says that faith is the confidence in things hoped for and the evidence of things unseen. So faith in God is believing in God and trusting in God. But it's even more than that, because in the book of James, I think it's James 2, it says that even the demons believe. So it's also being committed to God as well. In James 1 and 26, I think it says that faith without works, or faith without action, is dead. So faith in God is not only believing and trusting him, but it's being committed to him as well. A lot of people would say that, you know, faith is just blind, but it says the evidence of things unseen. See, there's evidence in people's lives that faith in God is real. And God shows himself in many, many ways. There is a story, a young boy in Sunday school was asked, what's faith? And he says, believing in things that are not true. But, and a lot of atheists now think that it's faith is this hope thing that doesn't really exist, but science is knowledge. And they put science up against God, and they put knowledge up against faith. But faith is a knowledge in who God is. It's who we've got faith in that's important for me. If you take medicine, if somebody takes medicine, one person will maybe look into it and want to know a lot about who made it up and why you do that. Another person will just say, oh, I trust and I'll take the medicine. The medicine is effective for both people, even if one had doubts in it. So it's a little bit like faith in Jesus. It's effective, even if you've got doubt. And having doubt doesn't mean to say they haven't got faith. In the Bible, there was a man that came to Jesus and he said, Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. And Jesus saw great faith in him. So even if you doubt, but faith is a great thing. I don't want to take too much time, but faith is everything, really, and especially now people need to have faith, and faith in God is awesome. Yeah?
You ready for bed?
I'm shattered.
Hey, we're now going to have some worship. This is a song that Rachel and Josh recorded at home. I hope you enjoy it. It speaks about God being the God in the mountain and in the valley. There's nowhere that His grace and mercy can't find us, and God's grace and mercy is there for each and every one of us. Enjoy this song and please worship along.
Then you came along.
I'm going to focus on our prayer points now, and so many things to pray for, so many people to pray for, those that are ill, especially those with the virus, but there are other things going on in people's lives as well, and we're not really mentioning too many individuals, but we do want to mention one tonight, Billy Cow, who we've been speaking about, who's been doing the online Alpha on Wednesdays. Billy has been taken into hospital with infections. It's affecting his chest, his heart, his kidneys, and you know, he really needs our prayer just now. So please, let's lift up Billy tonight and continue to pray for him this week. Everybody else that we know of that is ill, let's be praying for them just now as well. For those that are caring for them, for the doctors and nurses, it was great to hear from Madison tonight. And you know, we've got so many key workers, the pharmacies and the police, you know, and we're lifting you all up at this time. There's such a great need for you in this community, and we really are behind you at this time. We're praying for leaders in government. We're praying for the leaders in the churches, and we're praying for the community work that's going on as well. We're praying also for families who are homeschooling again and the challenges that go along with that. We're praying for households, for unity within the households. We're praying for those that have been suffering with mental health as well. It's a really crucial time, and you know, we're praying for peace and comfort in people's lives. We're praying for the families that have lost loved ones. That's going on, and there's been more this week, and we're just lifting them up as well. So let's not just take the next few minutes to pray, but we want to encourage you to be praying every day and lifting each other up and believing that God can make a difference in people's lives.